Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to thank you very much for your invitation to Canberra. It is a great pleasure and also honor to me to hold a presentation here today. Most of you will be familiar with this picture from the well-known Hollywood movie, The Terminator. The story always conveys the same message: the fear that cold machines, which have turned into intelligence beings, will dominate over mankind on the battlefield. With regard to 1916, 1917, this horror vision certainly is a little too far-fetched. But still, in view of the first appearance of such steel monsters, the machine was a commonly used term among the contemporaries of the battlefields of the Western Front. Regarding the German infantrymen confronted with the visit in September 1916 in the Somme trenches, these pictures invoked the same horror as the morbid future visions of the Terminator movies. A few months later, a German division commander wrote into his diary horrified, quote, "With its mass use of machine destruction tools, the war has now taken a form the human nerves of the troops just cannot handle anymore. A horrible situation," quote end. The bloody material battles near Verdun and at the Somme were the central military events of the year 1916 at the Western Front, ranging over 700 kilometers from the North Sea coast to the Swiss border, however, compared to the Eastern Front, a manageable area. These battles symbolizes deaths of millions on battlefields, soldiers, millions of soldiers on the battlefields, and the path towards a totalized mass warfare and industrialized machine warfare. Still, compared to mobile warfare, for example, neither the fights at the Somme nor in front of Verdun were those with the most losses. The most losses the German armies had in the offensive 1914 and 1918. The major difference distinguishing the battles of Verdun and that at the Somme from all previous ones was their duration and the immense effort of deployment troops and war material tied to it. While, for example, the first battle of the Marne in 1914 was decided with a few days on an approximately 150-kilometer front section, the Battle of Verdun, on a very tight space of not even 80 square kilometers, dragged on over more than 10 months. By the end of August 1916, 70 French and 47 German divisions had been deployed in front of Verdun with approximately 12 to 15,000 soldiers each. Altogether, this alone amounted to 1.7 million servicemen. After the 5 months fighting at the Somme, even 146 divisions had been employed at the German side after repeated deployment. At the end of June 1916, 3,000 Allied guns had taken under fire the German positions for a week, which approximately 2.5 million artillery grenades and mortars to prepare for the offensives, numbers that illustrate to us the dimension of these tremendous battles of material which seem unimaginable today. Please allow me to use this topical break to lead over to the tactical role of the battles of Verdun and Somme for the modern warfare in the first half of the 20th century. It's quite amazing how fast the third OHL, Hindenburg and Ludendorff, accepted the realities of the previous despite war of attrition and distanced itself from the far vehemently uttered demand to decide the war against Russia on the battlefield. A general assessment of the situation led to the decision to preferably stabilize the German defense at the main front in the west. Consequently, the 3rd OHL finally discontinued the attack at Verdun at the beginning of September. Also, taking into consideration new Allied offensives to be expected in 1917, the army now had to establish again defense. According to the now clear tactical operation directive, the purpose of the transition to defending the Western Front was mainly the attrition of the opponent while seamlessly maintaining the own fighting power. Only the economical or more efficiency handling of all forces would allow creating the prerequisite for a later war-winning offensive and the annihilating of the annihilating the opponent with its superior resources in a military way. This was a crucial lesson learned from the previous loss-intensive battles of material. Thus, the third OHL also relied one type of warfare that connected the attrition and annihilation strategies in contemporary fashion. By contrast to Falkenhayn, so the new OHL had large backing and it communicated their own intent very openly to the army through the general staff officers. What the third OHL referred to here was mainly the modern technology advanced combined arms combat. If one wanted to conduct battles with as few losses as possible, one had to attempt to harmonize modern technology, firepower, and movement in attack as well as defense. This had already been the lessons learned from the loss-intensive mobile warfare in summer and autumn 1914. The infantry as a primary weapon had already believed then to be able to decide the battle alone, without assistance of artillery and technology, just by the old motto, forward march on the enemy, whatever the cost. Also, Falkenhayn had already worked towards the cooperation of all arms in combat and integrated warfare, innovative technology like machine guns, flamethrowers, poison gas, and increasingly also aircraft. It was the third OHL which consequently improved organization, equipment, tactical doctrine, and training, and the heavy relied on the experience of from the battles of Material at Verdun and at the Somme. As a consequence, the battlefield of 1918 already reflected the war picture of the combined ground and air operations of World War II. While in 1914, Amiens had still moved into the battlefield and conducted combat in the 19th century manner with masses of infantry, partly in colored in uniforms. The OHL ultimately decided that the command level responsible for mobile combined arms warfare was to be the infantry division. This decentralization still been under dispute during the Somme battle, as the army high commands or general commands mainly had themselves the command of the artillery. In 1916, there were still parallel structures of structurally different divisions with three or four infantry regiments. Subsequently, the infantry division assumed a standardized basic structure as a so-called battle unit in combat. One infantry brigade with three regiments, about 3,000 soldiers each, one artillery command with one field artillery regiment, 36 field cannons and light howitzers. In 1918, an additional battalion of the foot artillery with 12 heavy howitzers and 10 centimeter cannons. One engineer battalion with a minethrower company, logistical, medical, and signal units. Depending on the mission, the individual divisions received army troops and other forces as attachments. Like the higher headquarters, they remained true to their ground. That means they had a steady location in their front selection. While the divisions constantly shifted positions at different front sections, from trench division, Stellungsdivision, to responsive divisions, Eingreifdivisionen, as a reserve behind them, with some breaks to rest in a rear echelon in order to maintain their sustainability. In 1918, particularly, mobile divisions were formed for attack purposes, but their basic organization conformed to the trench division. In addition to the artillery gun, the machine gun had established itself as a main armament in combat. The firepower of the infantry regiment was already increased significantly in the summer of 1916 and spring of 1917. Throughout the setup of two additional machine gun companies, which up to each 12 heavy machine guns, 08, the number climbed to 36 per regiment from just 6 in 1914. The machine gun sniper detachment with a further 36 heavy machine guns OA was another component of the division. In 1970, the infantry companies were gradually equipped with a light machine gun OA-15, allowing the reduction of the infantry forces effective strength. The machine's firepower thus replaced men in modern combat. The standardization of the organization was accompanied by a swift harmonization of the army tactical doctrines of employment. At the end of 1916 and the beginning of 1917, the OHL at first used the defense battle in trench warfare Vorschrift, followed the beginning of 1918 with the attack in trench warfare Vorschrift. Two crucial command and control regulations, which were supplemented by individual new training regulations for the branches of service. For example, the Ausbildungsvorschrift für die Fußtruppen im Krieg, training regulation for foot troops in warfare. For the infantry, they were updated constantly through the exchange of latest combat experience and the contents distributed to the troops via an extensive network of schools, training areas, and courses. The principle of German regulations was to strictly reject tactical schematicians, refer more to advantages and disadvantages of certain procedures, and allow the commanders of all levels extensive freedom of action in order to be prepared for situation adaptation in combat. This corresponded to the Auftragstaktik, mission command, which is established itself in German army since the turn of the last century. The new command and control regulations for defense battle and the attack breathed in a sense the spirit of mobile combined arms warfare at division level. As already mentioned, the regulations reflected the combat experience of the battles of material. Essentially, Verdun was an experienced field for attacks, the Somme was regarded as quote, sophisticated training ground for the German army for the defense battle in trench warfare, quote end. How did this trench warfare take place in the middle of the war tactical between attack and defense? In all European armies, the offensive dominated, but the firepower of even a few machine weapons, stringent defense, so that with the transition to the trench warfare at the end of 1914, the central question arose for the military leaders of both sides. How to frontally break through the opponent's field defense and move on to operational mobile warfare before the defender was able to bring his reserves by railway from behind to the front. This pressure of time had made the tactical mobility of the troops the deciding factor of operational warfare. However, the yet insufficient motorization greatly restricted the mobility of the infantry in World War I, and the effect of modern machine weapons limited the options to use the cavalry. In World War I, particularly at the Western Front, it hardly played a role anymore. In order to conduct at least attacks limited in space, the infantry required the artillery covering fire. On the German side, Colonel Hans von Seeckt successfully tested a tactical attack technique that was also used in a similar way of Verdun. The idea, after surprising troop deployment, the assault-like hail of grenades from the most heavy guns and mine launchers was to shake the morale of the opponent and clear the way fast for their own infantry. The fire of the guns and the advance of infantry were for the first time regulated according to the clock. In order to improve the protection of the infantry during the combat assault, all sides, including the 5th Army in front of Verdun, for example, fell back upon the cold creeping barrage. This was a thick hail of grenades hitting in closely in front of the advancing infantry forces, now regulated according to an exact time shuttle. Such plans were still necessary as the equipment of the troops with modern means of communication, like radio, was still insufficient. The artillery's fire control also increasingly depended on aerial target acquisition. Also for the Verdun plans or the Somme plans or other attacks, the German side for the first time incorporated airplanes into their reconnaissance purposes on a grand scale. The air sovereignty over the hard battlefields of the West Front in summer of 1916 up to the year 1917 was held by the British and French. It was particularly from their enemies that the Germans learned how tactical combined combat of artillery and air components work effectively. As far as use of the new ammunition was concerned, both sides increasingly made use of poison gas grenades, in particular against artillery targets. After the German infantry had only defended one line at the beginning of the trench warfare, the artillery effective forced them already in 1915 beginning to conduct more in-depth formations and deconcentration in the defense at the Western Front. The force of the massive Allied artillery barrage at the Somme caused high losses, which gradually led to the German practicing the later called elastic area defense. This front line was only sparsely manned. The mass of the infantry fought in a dispersed group formation, also applying the new stormtroop tactics in a position area that became deeper and deeper. Until in 1917, the defense zone was several kilometers deep. Forward area, main battle area, and rear combat area. This backbone of the defense was formed by the heavy machine guns arranged in the terrain like a chessboard. The mobile main element of the defense comprised immediate counter source of a shuttled counterattacks of the infantry reserves, which were supported in cooperation with the individual artillery command groups. Since Falkenhayn's rigid principle at the Somme was to hold every inch of enemy territory, the losses of the German troops continued to be immensely high. This rigid attitude was only given up at the end of 1916 and beginning 1917 for the benefit of a more flexible warfare, which also allowed the troops to make aviations and abound in non-maintainable positions. The German enhanced their methods of attack in the course of 1917. Whereas the Entente armored their guns and machine guns and mounted them on tracked cross-country mobile vehicles, the German developed the artillery, infantry, and stormtroop tactics as leadership principle based on the conventional means available. Its cornerstones were mobility, flexibility, rapidness, and surprise. The prerequisite for a successful attack was exact coordination with the artillery. Small raiding patrols, some concentrated in stormtroops equipment with light machine guns, grenade launchers, flame guns, and hand grenades following their own rolling barrage, maneuvering in a depth structure where to penetrate the weakest part of the enemy trench system. They were to advance to break through the trench system without paying regard to open flanks and abundant enemy elements. They were followed by battle groups tasked with eliminating still existing pockets of resistance. Ground attack aircraft supported the attack. The aim of the infiltration tactics was to turn local success into a rapid breakthrough, regardless of the threat to the flanks. All actions centered around the initiative and tactical agility. As in the defense, there was also an individualization of tactics in the attack. Small battle groups led by young officers and older experienced NCOs became the pillars of combat. One result of this was a decline in the influence of the medium and higher level of command on both battle and troops. Another was a reduction in the possibilities to influence and control the soldiers. To regain these possibilities and to improve the fighting morale, the OHL introduced patriotic education, in addition to the tactical innovations. This regulation focused on the tactical movement of the breakthrough. According to the OHL, the schematic methods of attack as well as the open preparations for launch countermeasures in time and had thus prevent the breakthrough. Surprise, however, was only possible if the artillery opened the burst fire unexpectedly and without days of spotting fire. But without spotting fire, the artillery had a low chance of hit and even endangered its own force while attacking. Captain Erich Pulkowski solved this dilemma by developing the Pulkowski method, Pulkowski's Verfahren, which based on eliminating the daily influence by way of calculations. After only a few guns in the hinterland had adjusted fire, the other guns were able to engage any own target with a high probability using previously compiled firing tables. The prerequisite for a surprise attack were thus met. At the same time, Lieutenant Colonel George Bruchmüller, nicknamed Durchbruchmüller, Breakthrough Müller, had developed a method of attack for the artillery that had been used at the Eastern Front since 1917. For both the preparation for the attack and the infantry and the support during the assault, it proved its worth in conquest of Riga in 1917. Bruchmüller divided artillery into three groups, counter-infantry groups, or IKA, counter-artillery groups, AKA, and deep battery artillery, FAKA. At the same, he centralized the command and control of the artillery against the resistance of some artillery commanders. In addition, Bruchmüller developed a new technique for firing gas, the so-called Bundschießen, color fighting. Derived from the color marks of the grenades, yellow cross, mustard gas, green cross for skein, and blue cross, a word I can't say it in English, a very chemical word, he combined all three warfare agents in artillery fire, thus enabling concentrated and organized fire at the enemy artillery. The gas selections of the front, often contained with mustard gas for flank protection, were called colored spaces. The artillery strikes lasted not longer several days, but only a few hours. The bravery of the artillery fire did not result in complete destruction of the enemy positions, but in the impact on the morale. Well, it was enormous. At the same time, destruction was kept within limits, thus making it easier to bring up their own artillery, which was a crucial factor for the attack. After a short fire rate of all batteries, all enemy positions were for approximately 10 minutes, the second phases of the artillery strike began in accordance with the Bruchmüller's method of attack, the disabling of the enemy artillery with gas. Almost all batteries apart from FICA were used for this purpose. Approximately 1 hour later, the IKA began to engage enemy artillery positions, while the AKA continued to engage the enemy artillery fire with gas. Since it was almost impossible to coordinate the artillery due to lack of communication means. The altering bombardments followed a minutely detailed time schedule. Both artillerymen and infantrymen had scrupulously adhered to this plan. After an exactly measured rolling salvo, the rolling barrage that affected the enemy positions, immediately in front of the attacking infantry, advancing laps of 100 meters further into the enemy trench system. The infantry, maneuvering in small raiding patrols, was able to follow its own rolling barrage. Raiding patrols and fire teams, sometimes concentrated in storm troops, were to infiltrate enemy positions and to bypass pockets of resistance in order to engage the hostile artillery in the depths of the position area. They were to be followed by battle groups, tasked with eliminating the pockets of resistance, while the raiding patrols fed the attack in the depths. The use of initiative had priority in all actions at this time. Thank you very much.